O Lord and ruler of the hosts of heaven, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and of all their righteous offspring, you made the heavens and the earth with all their vast array. All things quake with fear at your presence. They tremble because of your power. But your merciful promise is beyond all measure. It surpasses all that our minds can fathom. O Lord, you are full of compassion, long-suffering, and abounding in mercy. You hold back your hand. You do not punish as we deserve. In your great goodness, Lord, you have promised forgiveness to sinners, that they may repent of their sin and be saved. And now, O Lord, I bend the knee of my heart and make my appeal, sure of your gracious goodness. I have sinned, O Lord, I have sinned, and I know my wickedness only too well. Therefore, I make this prayer to you. Forgive me, Lord, forgive me. Do not let me perish in my sin, nor condemn me to the depths of the earth. For you, O Lord, are the God of those who repent, and in me you will show forth your goodness. Unworthy as I am, you will save me in accordance with your great mercy, and I will praise you without ceasing all the days of my life. For all the powers of heaven sing your praises, and yours is the glory to ages of ages. Amen.
Bless the Lord who forgives all our sins.
His mercy endures forever.
We will now pray the Decalogue together. Let us pray.
Hear the commandments of God to his people. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of bondage. You shall have no other gods but me.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not make for yourself any idol.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not invoke with malice the name of the Lord your God.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
Honor your father and your mother.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not commit murder.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not commit adultery.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not steal.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not be a false witness.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not covet anything that belongs to your neighbor.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ.
with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you know that we have no power in ourselves to help ourselves. Keep us both outwardly in our bodies and inwardly in our souls, that we may be defended from all adversities which may happen to the body, and from all evil thoughts which may assault and hurt the soul. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Then shall I be whole and Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. The message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and the discernment of the discerning I will thwart. Where is the one who is wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the debater of this age? Has not God made foolish the wisdom of the world? For since in the wisdom of God, the world did not know God through wisdom, God decided through the foolishness of our proclamation to save those who believe. For Jews demand signs, stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to Gentiles. But to those who are to call, both Jews and Greeks, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God, for God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
His disciples remembered that it was written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then said to him, "What sign can you show us for doing this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it up." The Jews then said, "This temple has been under construction for 46 years, and will you raise it up in 3 days?" But he was speaking of the temple of his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples remembered that he had said this, and they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Thank you.
Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful and kindle in us the fire of your love. Amen. As Christians, you know, when we use the wisdom of the world, we have to admit how odd our faith looks. For we claim that the most important divine action in history is the humiliating death of a poor Jew on a cross at the hands of an occupying power. The central Christian symbol of our faith, the cross, an instrument of torture and death, should evoke an image of horror. Instead, we use the word blessing in relation to the cross. Instead of a dramatic demonstration of God's power, the world sees weakness and failure. And we say, this is a blessing. How odd it is to speak of the cross as a blessing. At best, it is a paradox. And at worst, a contradiction. Paul seemed aware of this paradox in his first letter to the Corinthians when he wrote, "For the message about the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." The cross, an instrument of horror and torture, is a blessing. It is a blessing in disguise. The message is paradoxical. I mean, God reveals God's self in powerlessness. God reveals God's true self by becoming weak and vulnerable. And we are formed as a community of faith around what seems to be utter foolishness. Yet an instrument of torture and death is used for the salvation of the world. Some in this world see a Messiah who suffers and dies. Yet out of this death, God brings resurrection and new life. For Paul, the cross was the supreme instance of God's wisdom and power. The cross is what defines the community of faith, not whether they are Jews or Greeks or wise or unlearned. In the community of faith, Paul says, the wisdom of the world, when faced with the wisdom of God, does not have power. And what we declare in the cross of Jesus Christ might appear to the world a message of humiliation and shame. But when we cling to that cross with faith, when we put our full trust in the Lord, we begin to define true wisdom and true value. Because it is not through the world's wisdom that we come to know God. We come to know God through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus. And his cross defines our relationship with one another and with the Lord. God's foolishness in the cross leads us to question what we value. Because when we cling to the values of the world, the cross becomes a stumbling block for many. Seeking our identity in the wisdom of this world will find us falling away from God. Is it any wonder then that when Jesus entered the sacred temple that day and saw that it had been taken over by buyers and sellers, consumers and marketers, the values of the world, he overturns the tables and upsets the entire temple system. See, this was the normal, expected way of doing things. Now, sure, there would have been some took advantage of pilgrims coming into the city to attend the Passover festival, but for the most part, this was routine life in the temple, especially around holy days. Without these vendors, the system did not work. And this structure with its rules and order, its vendors and the priests, were all a part of what each individual had to navigate to come into the presence of God. This was the system, the arrangement that existed. But as God reaches out to save us, to redeem us, some values, some systems have to change. And in the end, God took up residence not within the inner sanctuary at the temple, but in the life of Jesus of Nazareth. And for John, who places this account of the cleansing of the temple at the beginning of his gospel, unlike the other gospel writers who place this story toward the end of their gospels, this is the moment that deepens John's understanding of Jesus' true identity. And this is when he gains a new understanding of the temple. But this is the moment for John when the old and the new dwelling place of the Lord collide, so to speak. Jesus, by overturning the tables, Jesus, the new dwelling place of the Lord, the temple, the old place, dwelling place of the Lord, figuratively speaking, as we know God is in the temple, God is in the church. But Jesus, by overturning the tables, not only interrupts the entire system, as we read, causing the religious leaders to want a miraculous sign, but he was speaking and acting God's truth, God's foolishness, as the prophets before him had so boldly proclaimed. I mean, the authorities were not looking for truth or a miracle. They wanted some proof as to who this man was and why he was doing this. And so Jesus responded by pointing to a completely different temple, his own body, the very dwelling place of God. And of course, they misunderstand. They had not experienced Christ's death and resurrection yet. So it would be difficult to understand these words of Jesus. The leaders seek to destroy him, as we know, and think that the deed is done. John notes that it wasn't until after Jesus' death and resurrection the disciples remembered these words and believed. And even though we know the rest of this story, we know the story, this story continues to be difficult for many to understand and believe. And Lent is the time to remind us that the story of Jesus culminates at the cross, but does not end there. And this foolishness to the world is God's wisdom. And this foolishness should cause us to look at what we value. Jesus was turning upside down an entire understanding of the temple and why it existed. And instead of it existing for the glory of God, it existed for its own personal agenda and profit. And the same stumbling block exists in the church today. I mean, the church does not exist for personal agendas and profit, believe it or not. The church is here for the glory of God. We're not here to make ourselves feel good. I mean, we are here for the glory of God. And it is ironic that the only way we can actually accomplish what we all most deeply want, our own ultimate happiness, is to give up our own agendas, to give up the values of this world, and give ourselves to God's agenda and God's values. So the cross challenges us to ask, you know, are we about God or are we about ourselves? I mean, people still want signs, seek wisdom, crave power, and ignore truth. But it is in Christ, in his word and act, in his death and resurrection, that the truth is revealed to us about who God is, who we are, and what God has to do with us, and what we have to do with one another. I mean, it would seem to the world that our faith is formed around what looks to be utter foolishness. But what looks foolish to the world is actually God's wisdom. And this is the paradox of our faith and the blessing that brings salvation and new life. So we can celebrate what the world sees as foolishness, believing instead that nothing is impossible with God, not even saving, redeeming this beautiful, broken creation with what seems like a crazy, amazing love.
As Moses ascended the mountain of God, So we seek to draw closer to God and to discern God's purposes for us and for the world. Make us ready, faithful, and eager servants whose actions always follow directly upon our prayers. The law of the Lord is perfect,
and revives the soul.
We pray for the church, and especially for its witness of love and reconciliation. We pray for lay and clergy leaders, for the Anglican Communion, for this diocese, and for our companions in mission and ministry. The testimony of the Lord is sure,
and gives wisdom to the innocent.
We pray for peace in the world and in all human hearts. We pray for national and world leaders, for those who carry arms in battle, and for those caught in the fury of war. We pray especially for this country and for a healing of the divisions among us. Teach us new ways to deal with conflict and help us to remember to seek in the face of our enemy the face of Christ. The statutes of the Lord are just,
and rejoice in the heart.
We pray for ourselves and our families, and for those who are sick or in need, especially the Lohr family and the Barnards, Dave Keenan, Edith Ann Power, Donald Williams, Jane Orsic, Petey Way, Marion Ralph Somerville, Ed and Bill Fillet, Pat Trentham, Eric White, Liam Ely, John Wise, Michelle Vincent, and Morgan Carpenter.
Merciful God, remember us and all those whom we hold in our hearts. In these 40 days, teach us to do the work of our baptism, and so daily to raise to you the needs of the world. Grant this through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Palm Sunday, 4 weeks to Easter. I mean, it is hard to believe that that is moving so quickly. This Thursday, Wednesday night, we have our luncheon program, soup and bread. And then on Thursday night, we have the ECW. We'll be meeting to kind of look at maybe some things we're going to be doing for next year. This Saturday, at least two of our people will be going to the second part of the training that they had to go to for this luncheon program. Also, we have second Saturday cinema at 2 o'clock this Saturday, and we're watching... Next Sunday is the vestry meeting. In 2 weeks on Palm Sunday, I thought that we might share some food together, because I know everybody will be busy going here and there. On Easter, we will have our Easter egg hunt and all those good things. But Palm Sunday begins Holy Week. And in the past, on the Monday Thursday night, we have had a Seder dinner. And so if you're interested in being a part of Seder dinner, I'd like for you to sign up so that I know whether we'll have enough people really to get that on this year. So that's April 2nd, a Thursday night. In the past, we've charged $5, and that just covered the food. And then, so it's coming up quickly. That's 3 weeks from this Thursday, believe it or not. So everybody have a good couple of weeks. Yeah, the nice weather. Very good. Yeah, it's wonderful. We're going to have some spring weather, and we hope it lasts. Any birthdays? So Tucker, how old are you? Seven. Wow. You're really getting up there. You feel like you're that old? Can we say a prayer for you? Okay. Let us pray. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on this your servant Tucker as he begins another year. Grant that he may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen his trust in your goodness all the days of his life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Happy birthday. Did you get everything you wanted? He's been eating a blue thing. Any anniversaries? The law of the Lord revives the soul. The word of the Lord is sure and gives wisdom to God's people. Hymn number 685. Thank you. of heaven and earth, you bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Paschal feast. That fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Stay our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
These are the gifts of God, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on them in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Thank you.
in your dealings. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen.
Of Christ.
Thanks be to God.